meeting we have from covering most regions. And so part of this is the solidarity that and cooperation, which is Article 13 of the Universal Declaration on Bioethics and Human Rights. So what we're going to do is we'll have a introduction, as we do every time, with housekeeping, and then we'll have the three presentations, which I think usually are around 6 to 8 minutes. So we go finish that, and then we all have this discussion, which Professor Mary will be moderating. Colonel Professor Derek will also be moderating the chat box and managing, coordinating the whole program. So with that, we'll start. Is there anything that you'd like to ask me? Yes, sir, Arun?
Manisha, you said you won't be able to stay the full time.
Yeah, what I see. Yes, I said. So we'll have your part ask you. Mary is aware of that, and Derek. So we'll have your part of it in the first, you know, soon after we finish the presentations. Okay. Thank you very much, all of you. One of the other things that we usually would like, and I told Arun, Dr. Arun, this, that usually at the webinar conference, we come up with a summary or a paper, a manuscript, looking at some of these, what actually happened. Particularly in this case, you're talking about the ethical and moral, and this is to be published in the Global Bioethical Inquiry, which is an international journal of the UNESCO chair, which is an index journal. So Dr. Arun will coordinate, and all of, you know, all your contribution will be the co-authors to that. Okay, any other questions? Then we might open it.
Yeah, I think we can go ahead. Derek, don't forget to record once they're in, okay? You're muted. You're muted, Derek.
Yeah, I'm doing that. Yes, Dr. Russell.
Okay. A very good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and good night to all the participants, members, and so forth from on for the 47th of the series of international panel discussion webinar conferences that have been taking place since the start of this pandemic. So welcome to all of you. Today, of course, we have a very, very important and interesting theme and panel discussion on the moral and ethical challenges to anesthesiologists working with the COVID pandemic. And we are delighted that, as we usually do, we have colleagues from most of the regions of this of the world going to be joining us with three presentations that sort of set the scene, and then we move on to the panel, international panel discussion, and we have a very distinguished list of international panel members who you'll be delighted to listen, and of course, you will be given an opportunity to ask your questions and so forth. So before I do go any further, as we normally do, can I invite Professor Dr. Mary Matthew, the co-chair of this program, to also welcome you and address you?
Thank you, Dr. Russell, and hi, everyone. Good day to all. I'm Mary Matthew. I'm the head of the Indian program of the International Chair in Bioethics, and I'm also a pathologist by profession. And it's really wonderful to see a new group of people today They are the anesthesiologists, and we hardly know what they have been doing behind the scenes during this COVID-19 pandemic. And this webinar will unravel and tell us what are their difficulties, the ethical issues that they face during this COVID-19 pandemic. I also welcome all our participants. Some of you are regulars and have been joining these webinars. This is our 47th webinar, which we started successfully from the time from last year during the COVID pandemic, and it's been going on, and we are still finding that there are many more issues that we need to address and need to hear from different professions and different aspects, the ethical aspects. So welcome to this webinar, and I hope all of you have a lovely time. And I thank all the speakers and the panelists for taking time out to come and join us and share your experiences. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Professor Mary. Can I get Derek, Professor Colonel Derek D'Souza will give you the welcome you and give you the housekeeping rules.
Yes, a very warm welcome. Good to see some new faces. Good to see old friends again. And I hope this will just be the start to have new additions to this family of the alternate Sunday webinars that we have. I've posted a link to YouTube Live in the chat box, so you may feel free to share that with your friends and other colleagues who are unable to log in to the webinar for any reason. You may also keep that same link, and the recording of this webinar will also be available. We have the chat box running simultaneously. All of you have access to it, all the people who are participants on this webinar. Please type in your questions or comments that you have. And I have a request to all our speakers and our panelists that during the discussion, or when you are not speaking, you may look at the chat box. And if you feel you can address the issues there, please go ahead and type in your comments or type in your answer so that we save time and we don't have to take all the questions during the live discussion. In addition to that, we have very distinguished teachers and faculty here. We have a lot of students in attendance. So you may also share some documents or some links or any other material that you feel would be good for reading or getting a better understanding of some of the issues that are being discussed. So you may share it in the chat box. If there is any difficulty, you may also send it to me on email and we'll send it to all the participants later on. So welcome once again. It's good to have you, and I'm sure we're going to have a wonderful discussion. Back to you, Dr. Russell. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Derek. Are you planning to, for the teachers, Derek, is that, you have something for that? Or do we just, you're muted.
You're muted.
Derek, you're muted.
Muted, Derek.
You can introduce the panel till then, Dr. Hassan.
Want to know, are you still planning to have that?
Yes, I'm just pulling that up.
All right. Okay, good. Now I'm going to introduce one of the important things. I think we're just recognizing today is a Teacher's Day in India. And in Australia, it's Father's Day. So we take this opportunity to congratulate and wish all the teachers who are here from India and indeed from all around the world. I could see Deborah from Brazil, Sonia, Karen from, we have a lot of colleagues from Europe, all over the world will be joining us. Welcome to all of you, and even Georgia. So, happy Teachers' Day to all the teachers, and for those from Australia, happy Father's Day. Today's Father's Day. Okay, and now I'll introduce. Today we're going to have, as we usually do, three presentations that will set the scene. So we're going to have Dr. Arun Mehra, who is of course part of this program, but he's a consultant in anesthesiology at the Bhagwati Hospital in New Delhi. And of course, he's got his management, his administration, and a diploma in creative writing. He's got all these wonderful things, including ethics, qualifications in ethics. And he's a faculty member of the Indian program of the International Chair on Bioethics, faculty at the Healthcare Management, editor of medical and nursing textbooks. So, and we then have Dr. Manisha Mehta, who is a consultant anesthetist from Aberdeen Royal Infirmary, and a honorary senior clinical lecturer at the Aberdeen Medical School, college tutor, and the final FRCA examiner for the Royal College of Anesthetists. And she's the unit clinical director of medicine, division of medicine at the National Health Service in the Grampian. So welcome, Dr. Manisha. Welcome, Dr. Arun. And finally, we have Dr. Kevin Wee Shan, who is from Malaysia. He's a medical lecturer, Department of Anesthesiology, Faculty of Medicine at the University of Malaya, in KL, in Kuala Lumpur, and he's a member of the Malaysian Medical Council, Deputy Secretary of the Malaysian Medical Association, Chairman of the Section Concerning House Officers, Medical Officers and Specialists, and a member of the Private Healthcare Productivity Nexus, Malaysian Productivity Cooperation, and of course, a member of the National Patient Blood Management Committee. So these are going to be our presenters today, and we'll also join as the international panel members. And further down, I think we have another distinguished lot of panel members, Dr. Ashok Sharma, Dr. Ashok Saxena, who's the professor and head of Department of the Anesthesia and Critical Care at the University College of Medical Sciences in Delhi, in India. And then we have also distinguished Dr. Jonathan Ahrens, who's the chief anesthesiologist at the Coral Springs Medical Center in Florida, in the United States. We'll also have another distinguished colleague, Dr. Joyce Ongaya, who is the consultant anesthetologist at Kenyatta University in Nairobi, in Kenya. And then we have Dr. Manpreet Singh, who's a professor of anesthesiology and critical care at the Government Medical College in Chandrigarh. And welcome to you too, Dr. Manpreet Singh, and Dr. Amit Sharma, who is the senior consultant at the Department of Anesthesia and ICU at the Primus International Super Speciality Hospital in Abuja in Nigeria. So welcome to Dr. Amit Sharma, and welcome to all these panelists. So before we start the presentation, Dr. Arun Mehra will be the first presenter, then we'll have Dr. Manisha Mehta Kumar, and then Dr. Kevin. So before we do this, I think Professor Derek is wanting to, this is part of the acknowledging the teachers in this. All of us are, most of us are teachers here. So he's going to be putting something up for you.
Thank you, Dr. Russell. And I just thought, since we are from the Department of Education, and education is something that we take very seriously, all of us who are here, and even the students as well. It's a wonderful day for us to be. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, yes, we can hear you.
So it's a wonderful day to be together, and I thought I'll put a small tribute today to all the teachers and to all of us as an inspiration to go ahead and continue this wonderful work that we are doing. So I'll just share my screen, and I hope this brings back fond memories to the more senior lot, and maybe it's an inspiration to the juniors to go back and watch this particular movie that I show you a small clip from, To Serve with Love. I hope the screen is visible and you can hear the sound.
But you can increase the sound.
So thank you, everyone. Thank you all, the teachers, and thank you to everyone for continuing to inspire your students and be a part with us this wonderful day. Back to you, Dr. Russell.
All right. Thank you very much, Derek, and happy Teachers' Day. This is the Department of Education that is hosting these webinar conferences. So let's start with our program. And Dr. Arun Mehra, can I hand it over to you? Who will be our first presenter?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. And I'll just start sharing my video. So, friends, the topic I am taking up today is, the sociological basis of anesthesia, of ethics in anesthesia and critical care. Now, ethics is...
Can you just make that full screen, Dr. Mehra?
Full screen, yeah.
Sure, just a minute.
F5, you can press F5 or, yeah.
Where is it?
Once more.
Yeah, is that okay?
Yeah, perfect. Go ahead, thank you.
So as society has evolved, basically, it is social norms that have brought about ethics, and ethics is what has made society possible in the first place. So what I'll really talk about is something that might be slightly new to people. It's not really taught in medical school, the sociological basis of ethics. First of all, this is one quotation which I really liked. What is the society's role, not only the doctor's role, but the society's role in an individual's sickness? And that is, your job is not to judge, your job is not to figure out if someone deserves something. Your job is to lift the fallen, to restore the broken, and to heal the hurting. Now, medical sociology is a huge, huge thing. We can't discuss it here. But there's just one aspect that I want to give you a very brief introduction to, because that is what we will be dealing during the course of this discussion, and that is called sick role. Talcott Parsons was an American scientist, a scientist of humanities, actually, who was regarded as the father of sociology. He studied sociologies of various professions, various societies, everything, including medical sociology. And in 1951, he coined a term which he called the sick role. Now, the sick role is something which, according to him, it's a behavioral pattern of the society. That the society expects of a sick person with both rights and obligations. And he says that being sick or being ill is not just a biological condition, but it places a social role on a person, and a different set of norms is assigned to that person. Now, the rights of a sick person is that he is exempt from work and from other social roles for that brief period of time. And he has an obligation to seek treatment and to follow that treatment and get better so that he can return to being a useful member of the society. Now, this has implications for ethics and morality. And it has evolved from 70 years ago when Talcott Parsons initially spoke about it. And many of the concepts have changed since that time. But the basic idea about the cultural issues involved, howsoever the culture itself may change from time to time, the cultural norms may change, but the cultural issues involved, the fact that culture affects a person's role in society when he is unwell, that idea has been with us for thousands of years. Now, before I go on, there are just certain criticisms. As I said, this has changed with time. Our present day understanding of what we call medical ethics or bioethics is not exactly what Talcott Parsons said. There have been changes. Just a few criticisms. It assumes that the individual voluntarily accepts the sick role. Now, individuals may not give up social obligations, and there are situations if a person has, say, a fracture of his tibia, there's no reason he can't go to work without support, maybe the support of a wheelchair, the support of a crutch, or something like that. Then the sick role stigmatizes the patient, which is something that is, well, those who have studied bioethics know that stigmatization is something that we really abhor. We don't want it, and we work against it constantly. Then, of course, the third point is that this is really valid for acute sicknesses, not for chronic sicknesses. These are just a few points. Now, I'd like to come to the main topic about what are the implications for anesthesia. First of all, the societal expectations, which are often removed from the realities of medical practice, have evolved across thousands of years. They cannot be wished away. So we have to understand that medicine cannot be practiced in a vacuum. And the social norms are there, and they will stay there, and they change from one century to the next. They change from one culture to the next. They change from one nation to the next. But they are there. They are not leaving us. And in fact, Article 12 of the Universal Declaration on Bioethics discusses about cultural diversity and how culture has to be respected. Now, where does this bring in the anesthesiologist? Well, those dealing with the sickest patients have to be especially sensitive to cultural and social issues. And anesthesiologists are the ones who deal with the sickest patients, and they have found that this has really been exacerbated in the pandemic, where all kinds of problems arise. People don't understand what the doctor. And reciprocally, the doctors don't understand what the people want. And in a totally globalized world, there are all kinds of cultural gaps also, which have been discussed on our previous webinars, how a person from one culture living in another country might not really be familiar, or those treating him might not be familiar with his home culture. So this cultural aspect is there. Coming to the individual implications. First of all, we have human dignity and human rights, which is Article 3 of the Universal Declaration on Bioethics. Human dignity and human rights have to be fully respected. Now, anesthesiologists and critical care specialists have to take many decisions which we can say. We can't be absolute in our judgment. We cannot judge people, but let's say that they seem to go against what we are taught about in human dignity. For instance, how to utilize scarce resources. We've all heard of cases where critical care specialists have had to decide whether to give a ventilator to a patient or to reserve it for another patient. And these are the kinds of decisions where human dignity is being impacted. And yet they are into situations where you really don't have any answers. One very familiar example would be, supposing you have a 65-year-old man who's fulfilled his life's obligations, another 35-year-old who has two small children, and he has a productive life ahead of him. Now, when you say that you have to give preference to the 35-year-old, that is economics. That's not morality. That's not ethics. That is economics. And yet, what is the poor doctor supposed to do in this situation? How does he take a decision? If he decides against either of those two, it goes against human dignity. Apart from the justice issue, it also goes against human dignity. And this can lead to a moral injury for doctors and other healthcare workers. Moral injury is a psychological problem. Dr. Russell has a very good grasp of it. And those who are here for the first time today, what is meant by moral injury. Then reciprocally, the dignity of the doctors too has been dealt a blow. We are familiar, especially I'll tell you, in my country, in India, there have been situations where doctors have not been allowed into their residential colonies or into their apartments for fear of being carriers of the infection. One of our faculty members was telling us on one of the webinars that he too, while returning from the hospital, was stopped by a policeman who said, "Why didn't you stay in your hospital itself?" So dignity has been affected both ways. And it's here that anesthesiologists are at the very forefront. So the very basic question in the sick role concerning the interest of the examined. This is more cultural than medical. Are we supposed to see the benefit to the society wherein we give the ventilator to the 35-year-old, wherein we try to quarantine a doctor? These are unjust practices and they go against human dignity. If we had more resources, perhaps these problems would not have arisen, but they are very real problems that are there. So this is one aspect where anesthesiologists have to really think, and at times they get into psychological traumas because of this. Now coming to benefit and harm, which is Article 4 of the Universal Declaration on Bioethics. Direct and indirect benefits to patients should be maximized and any possible harm should be minimized. This has more to do with medical research actually, but it applies to medical practice also. Now, as I have written here, the dividing line, which was always unclear, has been further blurred in the pandemic. It's often hard to decide for an anesthesiologist whether a patient should undergo surgery or it should be postponed, because there are so many risks involved. First of all, yes, we do perform the RT-PCR and other tests, but nothing is foolproof. If we operate upon one particular patient, if we allow him into the OT, we are risking exposure of the OT staff, of other patients, of everybody in that situation. And apart from that, there is this reciprocal risk that the patient may also acquire the COVID infection from the staff or from other patients. And besides, do we do the surgery is yet another issue, because denying the surgery again is against ethics. Again, it could come down to economics, but we have to analyze the risk versus the harm. In medical sociology, the sick role would also consider the reverse, that the individual must consider the benefits that he bestows on the society. As I said at the beginning, that the medical sociology, the sick role, considers that the patient has an obligation towards the society to get better so that he can continue with his productive role in the society. Excuse me. And medical sociology will consider this reciprocal role also. So this becomes a really pressing problem in a pandemic situation. What do you do in an OT? What do you do in an ICU in this situation? Then coming to autonomy, individual responsibility and consent. These are under Articles 5, 6, and 7 of the Universal Declaration on Bioethics. The autonomy of a person to take decisions while taking responsibility for those decisions. Mind you, that depends on the person's understanding and also on the doctor's ability to explain the consequences. And in anesthesia, of course, we have a lot of explaining to do to a patient before surgery, what are the best options for anesthesia in that particular patient's situation, because every patient is different. So the autonomy of persons to make decisions while taking responsibility for those decisions is to be respected. We have to respect that autonomy. But then who is responsible for people who are not able to exercise autonomy? That's another big question. And unfortunately, in the ICU, we often have patients who cannot take decisions, which is, well, normal in ICU. But in the COVID pandemic, we have had situations wherein no family member or anybody is around to take decisions on their behalf. Now, I'm speaking in terms of the Indian context. A friend in the United Kingdom recently told me that suppose she were to land up in the ICU, even her husband is not allowed to take a decision for her unless she has given the power of attorney to that individual who happens to be her husband. So these are again big dilemmas in anesthesia and critical care. In the present situation, patients are often too sick or too poorly informed also to take decisions. And we all know that unfortunately there has been far too much misinterpretation and misinformation during the pandemic. Sorry? Additionally, the sick role would absolve patients of responsibilities, which in turn would place an extra burden on the doctor. So this is one aspect of the sick role which really is not acceptable in terms of today's ethics as we understand it. Then coming to respect for human vulnerability and human integrity, which is Article 8, bioethics reminds us of the need for special protection of the vulnerable. Now, in the best of times, a person needing surgery is obviously a vulnerable individual, but he becomes more so in a pandemic, and especially in a pandemic like COVID. Now, this takes us back a few slides where I spoke about how do we decide whether to do surgery or not. Then another area of vulnerability becomes the inability of that person to earn an income. We know that many, many, many people have had a loss of income during this time. So all these issues put together create a whole new set of dilemmas for an anesthesiologist, for the surgeon also for that matter. The society's assumption, even at a subconscious level, of a sick role may exempt a sick person from normal duties, further increasing the need for special attention, because again, it becomes a circle going round and round. He has no income, then he falls sick, then he has to undergo some procedure which drains his resources, and again, he is not able to go and work. So what do we do in this situation? This is another aspect we have to deal with. Equality, non-discrimination, distributive justice, these mainly come under Articles 10 and 11, though these are separate areas in other times. In a pandemic, when the resources do not meet the requirements, they all become interlinked. Culturally, the society expects that all should receive fair treatment. This expectation is totally reasonable, but is impossible to fully implement even at the best of times. In a pandemic situation, it becomes infinitely worse. Again, it leads to moral injuries for healthcare workers, and anesthesiologists are at the forefront of this kind of situation. The workers who are dealing with sick patients, the sickest patients all the time. So also a cardiologist for that matter, and a few other specialties, but most of all, it is the anesthesiologists. Now, as I said before, there are things that will weigh upon their conscience. Definitely, guidelines and protocols have been made which help in reaching decisions. And we have committees, hospital committees, which can also be turned to for help. But in a pandemic where you have to take a lot of quick decisions, you don't really have the time to go to a committee. And while these protocols may help us in resolving some of these issues, it does not necessarily mean that the feeling of guilt or the moral injury gets reduced, because coming back to the example of the 35-year-old and the 65-year-old, whichever way the anesthesiologist or the other doctor decides, he will carry that guilt for the rest of his life. So here again, the social and cultural norms play a very large and often decisive role, which may leave the doctors absolutely frustrated and absolutely wrecked. Another issue is that culturally, doctors and health, this is slightly different. I have referred to this in an earlier slide. Another issue is that culturally, doctors and healthcare workers have been respected from times immemorial, but in the present scenario, they too are discriminated against, victimized, ostracized, especially those who deal with COVID, which includes anesthesiologists to a large extent, people not being allowed into their residential complexes and being shunned by the society for being carriers. The people may be, playing it safe, but that is definitely against the dignity of the healthcare worker and is discrimination. So there are many other aspects I can deal upon, but these were the main ones which I found very important, and for lack of time, because this is a lecture that could go on all day for that matter. So in conclusion, what I'd like to say is that culture affects the way people see healthcare, and this has got far-reaching implications. And it's been there since times immemorial, for thousands of years, even before Hippocrates, even, you know, in times when there was no medicine. In fact, this reminds me of something. I read a quotation recently where Margaret Mead, I'm sure most of you must have heard of Margaret Mead, the very, very famous anthropologist. She said, and this is worth mentioning here, she said that she was asked, when did society start? So she pointed out that some fractured bone was found somewhere, whether it was a femur or tibia, I don't remember. But it was found that it had healed. And she said, look, no living organism, whether human or animal, can survive after that kind of fracture, because the predators will simply come and eat that human being or that animal or whatever. The very fact that the bone got time to heal means something, somebody was looking after that person. And with somebody looking after that person, that, she said, is the beginning of society. So culture has evolved to make society possible. It's a reciprocal relationship. So we cannot wish away cultural activities, and we should not either, because culture is what makes our society possible. So the culture and sociological factors affect the working of a doctor, and the greater the contact with the sickest patients, the more the dilemmas that are posed. Anesthesiologists deal with some of the sickest patients, both in the operating room and in the ICU, even in normal times. Now, with a sick role mindset, Arson Talcott's sick role, with a sick role mindset, that has been culturally ingrained across centuries, probably across millennia. The pandemic has created severe new problems for doctors and for other healthcare workers, most importantly for those who deal with emergency and critical care situations like anesthesiologists. I'll just say that this pandemic is not the first time it has created this situation. It has happened in practically every century in every part of the world. We all know about the Black Death and so many other things. And just 100 years ago, there was the Spanish flu. But we now live in times where, number one, we have something we can do medically. And number two, our understanding of these issues with the evolution of biomedical ethics, with the evolution of sociology and the humanities, has given us an opportunity to really tackle these situations. Culture and social factors cannot be ignored in decision making. And I'd like to end with one quote. This is by a very famous German doctor. All knowledge, not medical knowledge alone, all knowledge attains its ethical value and its human significance only by the human sense with which it is employed. So it's actually the man, the human being, the man or the woman who gives it ethical value. Only a good man can be a great physician. With that, I'd like to conclude. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Arun. So let's have, we'll be discussing this further. But let's go to the...
Dr. Arun, you can stop sharing, yeah.
Yeah, to Dr. Manisha's Mehta Kumar, she's going to speak on very important because it's new legal and ethical issues in anesthesia and critical care during the pandemic. And I presume that this might have be applied from Dr. Manisha is Mehta is from the Aberdeen, and so we. In Scotland and United Kingdom. So we'll hear her aspect here put together. Okay, I think, oh yes, thank you. It's all good.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me to this discussion. I'm going to talk about the new ethical and legal issues in anesthesia and critical care during the pandemic. So, as Dr. Russell, this is as said, I work in Aberdeen, which is in the north of UK. We are actually in Scotland, which is a part of the UK. It's a beautiful city known for its granite architecture and lovely beaches and castles along the seacoast. So, the pandemic hit us in March last year when we were pretty much unprepared for it. The UK government, along with the government from Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland, worked together to produce a guidance on how healthcare professionals should be dealing with it. They also provided us with ethical framework on how to manage. Various other societies and Royal Colleges provided guidance. Public Health England produced guidance for health professionals and for managing the spread of infection. And then there were various other societies which produced what they thought was evidence-based guidance from what little evidence we had. The British Medical Association provided a supportive interpretation of the complexity of the situation and how the doctors can balance their duties in a crisis like that with the resource limitations that we all had all over the world. The General Medical Council at that time allowed us as doctors to work in whichever area we were needed to work in, whether so that anesthesiologists who were not normally working in intensive care units could work in intensive care units, and the surgeons who were made available because there was no elective surgery happening could help in whichever area, whether it was medical wards or whether it was intensive care units, to do whatever they could be quickly trained to do. The pandemic hit Italy first, and a lot of literature came out quickly from Italy on how they coped and what their struggles were with the pandemic. And I'm sure you're all aware of the initial images we saw when even 50-year-olds were declined ICU beds purely because they didn't have any. So sadly, even with so much guidance, none of these actually offer much reassurance to professionals in terms of litigation. The one thing that was highlighted repeatedly that communication is the key, and communication and documentation of all communication helps manage litigation for future. And it's not just communication. The communication needs to be in a language that the patients understand. And I'm sure you're all aware, the biggest issue was that all communication was using the telephone or using a virtual medium because there were no face-to-face conversations. No visiting was allowed. So the ethical framework behind all this was based on a few principles, the fundamental principles. The first one is that everyone matters. This means that healthcare decisions should respect the principles set out by the human rights and by the equality legislation. Everyone matters equally. However, this does not mean that everyone is given the same opportunity. I'll come to that later. The decision-making processes should be fair and equitable, as well as transparent. The decision makers need to be honest with patients and with the public on how decisions are made in a manner that the patients can actually understand what you are saying. There's no point using medical jargon with the patient. You have to simplify it to a language they will understand. Decision makers at all levels should find out what matters to the patient and what matters to the healthcare staff and support them in playing the active role in the shared decision-making processes. And as Arun has mentioned, moral injury to the healthcare staff is an important aspect. The harm that might be suffered by every person matters, so we have to minimize the harm that the pandemic might cause. The four principles of ethics are autonomy. The patients have to be given autonomy, and there has to be shared decision making. Like I said, we have to work with the people. We have to get them to understand what we are trying to say before any decisions are made. All individuals have the right to decide about their care and treatment, and they may wish to review or change their mind as well. Beneficence is the other principle. So within the resource constraints, we have to think of patients, how we can deliver the best care possible to the patient and make the best use of the resources available. We have to be flexible in what we do. With the changing situation, we have to evolve and change our management plan as and when needed. And there has to be reciprocity in the equation as well. When the clinicians are expected to take increased risks, such as working with COVID, there has to be adequate facility for protection of the clinicians. There has to be an appropriate personal protective equipment provided. Justice basically means that we need to have respect for the patients. All patients should have access to good quality and compassionate care. It has to be fair. Patients have to be treated individually with respect to their autonomy and not discriminated against for whatever reason. Their capacity has to be taken into mind when we are looking for consent. And lastly, it's non-maleficent. We have to make sure we are not doing any harm. Or if we can't do that, we have to make sure we are minimizing the harm that a situation will do, will cause. In terms of COVID, there were various issues to start with. Nobody was sure about what the mode of transmission was, whether it was an aerosol or whether it was droplet transmission or whether it was in the air itself. Social distancing was thought to be important. 2 meter distance was the recommended distance by the Public Health England and the infection prevention and control managers, which meant that bed spacing between beds in the hospital had to be increased to 2 meters. That meant that the number of beds we had in the hospital had to be reduced. The need for personal protective equipment cannot be stressed enough. And everybody had to learn how to don and doff the personal protective equipment. Donning is relatively easy, but doffing is the one that is complex. And infection control individuals are very confident that the fact that healthcare professionals got infected has more to do with how much they contaminated themselves while taking the personal protective equipment off. COVID intubations were a challenge for anesthetists. This is where we first got involved in intubating patients who had active COVID, whether they were in the casualty or whether they were on medical wards. So intubation teams were formed in every hospital in UK, which involved a consultant, a trainee, and an anesthetic assistant. Intubation trolleys and kits were set up with monitoring equipment. The teams were trained on how to rush to a situation, get geared up with personal protective equipment, check the equipment as per the checklist, and intubate the patient as safely as possible without contaminating others. And of course, then transfer the patient to the intensive care unit. Which brings me to the ethical issue then. Not every patient was given access to the intensive care unit. As intensive care units were not large enough for the anticipated number of patients we were going to get, the temporary facilities were built. I'm sure you've all seen pictures of hospitals and beds being created in the Millennium Dome in London and other cities in the UK. ICU beds were expanded in every hospital to 3 to 4 times the capacity they had, using anesthetists and nurses from all kinds of areas to provide the care. We even used surgeons and trained them to identify a deteriorating patient and a critically ill patient. We did not expect them to learn anesthetic skills, but at least they could help with monitoring and they could help with physical tasks like droning the patient when needed. But having seen the Italian situation where they ran out of beds and were unable to admit young patients, it was decided early on that we would go by triaging the patient and have admission criteria and admit only patients who could actually be improved. So only when we thought that prognosis was reasonable were they accepted. So as Dr. Arun has said, that a 35-year-old is admitted to ICU, but an 85-year-old is not. That doesn't have to do with age and fairness, but it has more to do with the fact that an 85-year-old with COVID lung disease is unlikely to recover from that if they need ventilatory support, whereas a 35-year-old has got more chance of improving. So it was deemed that only people who had a realistic chance of improving would be taken into intensive care units. Various criteria were used, including the pre-morbid status of the patient, such as the clinical frailty scale. I don't know, I think most of you must have seen this before. So this is a scale used to define what the status of the patient is. And if you look at number five is somebody who is mildly frail, but these patients are people who would need help and high order tasks at home, such as finances, transportation, heavy housework. Typically, mildly frail people are unable to go shopping or walking outside by themselves. They are unable to carry on housework by themselves. So if you think about it, this would be the elderly folk. When I say elderly, I mean people like above 85, 90, that kind of age, who are frail enough to be unable to manage their tasks. It's not just about age, it's about the physiological status of the patient. So people with that kind of a frail constitution are not going to cope with being ventilated. So for all patients with COVID who were admitted to the hospital, there were sealing of decisions made within 24 hours. So it was using the ethical framework, it was using shared consent, shared decision making, and informed consent. So within 24 hours of admission, it was decided what the maximum treatment for that particular patient would be with the patient's consent, with the patient's involvement. Similarly, there were decisions taken in the community, such as, again, a frail 90-year-old would not be taken into intensive care unit if they needed ventilatory support. Do not resuscitate decisions are quite often taken in the United Kingdom, even pre-COVID. A lot of patients do have advanced directives signed for what they do not want to be done to them if they come in with a certain condition. I'm talking again repeatedly about elderly patients because UK has got a large number of populations above the age of 75. So, and that is the population that really suffered with COVID. In terms of anesthesia, the issues were airway maneuvers are thought to be aerosol-generating procedures, which essentially means that there is an aerosol of the COVID virus, which everybody needs to be protected for. Intubation is thought to be aerosol-generating. A laryngeal mask airway is not believed to be aerosol-generating. Extubation is thought to be the most aerosol-generating procedure we undertake, and hence needs the maximum protection. Surgery was not thought to be aerosol generating unless it involves airways, dental drilling, or thoracic procedures. Pathways of care were defined. So the red pathway was for patients who had COVID. Amber pathways were patients with status unknown. And the green pathways were patients who were having scheduled procedures. Now, we didn't carry on many scheduled procedures during the COVID outbreak, but it was mostly procedures which were for urgent procedures or urgent cancer surgery. So these patients were treated under green pathway only if they had a negative PCR test 72 hours prior to admission, and they had to isolate for the 72 hours between the test and hospital admission. These were treated then as patients in non-COVID time. And the big ethical dilemma then we had was that patients, what do we do with patients who were refusing to be tested? I'm sure all countries and everybody has encountered patients or people who refuse to believe in the existence of COVID and refuse testing, it isn't fair to cancel their surgery. But on the other hand, is it fair to be using the scarce resources for such patients when you're really struggling? So the consequences which COVID had, doctors were working outside their usual area of practice. The legal framework, despite all this guidance, remained unchanged. And there was excessive scrutiny by the public and media, pretty much in every country. I'm sure you're all aware of images we saw on the television every evening, and the impact on healthcare professionals. This was not just an impact in terms of their health, but also in terms of their mental health, in terms of the moral injury aspect, and of course, loss of income as well. There were many interpretations of the legal standing of the guidance that we received. The pandemic resulted in so many concerns for everybody, in addition to the concern of litigation. The government's guidance actually states that the day-to-day management of patients and people is subject to legal framework, duty of care, candor, and moral obligation as before. The pandemic does not change that at all, which essentially means that the legal implications remain the same, even though we were told that we could work outside our usual area to help. And like I said, when demands increase to such extraordinary levels, the public and legal scrutiny actually increases. Most claims in ICU were related to patient positioning, nursing care, infections, respiratory infections. And again, coming back to Italy, which was the first country in the Western world to suffer, litigation has followed. Despite the call for immunity from various sectors, the Italian doctors were forced to allocate the scarce resources and asking for recognition that these actions were proportionate to the situation. The law does not support selective rationing despite the guidelines. The last aspect I want to speak about is the health debt that COVID has left us with. There's been a lot of delay in diagnosis and treatment of cancer. There's been inadequate treatment of chronic health conditions, leading to an increased incidence of acute coronary events and stroke and all such conditions. And there is, of course, a massive backlog of elective procedures. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha. Thank you very much for that very interesting talk. We are going on now to the next, and that's Dr. Kevin Shen, Ethical Problems in Administrative Management and Planning Implementation Issues in Anesthesia and Critical Care. Can I request you, Dr. Kevin, we are running out of time. I think,
yeah,
and so we just
keep to the time. Yes, I think, thank you very much for having me, Prof. Russell and the team. I think everything that I want to say has already been covered extensively by the first two speakers, and I will just be sharing a little bit about what we were doing here in Malaysia.
Good.
Right. Okay, I've got 12 slides.
Thank
so
you.
First case in Malaysia, January 25th, 2020. Initially, everybody was hiding behind saying that we will never get it and all that. And in August 18, 2021, we hit a record of 22,000 new cases in a day. So the first thing that we experienced, as well covered by the thing, was the fear of the unknown. It's a deadly disease, supposedly deadly disease. We do not know how it spread. We don't know how to treat it. So that was the first feeling that all healthcare workers had to deal with. So as the intensive care unit, we had to step up, and we quickly mobilized. We got our negative pressure rooms in order. We started a task force together with the infectious disease personnel. We were using a lot of the protocols that we were that we had prepared for MERS-CoV as the initial baseline for what we were going to do. The next thing that we faced, of course, was equipment. Nowhere in the world, I would say, would have been prepared for dealing with airborne disease. I would say, even as much as you are, how well you think you are prepared, you would never have stocked enough protective personal protective equipment. So that was the shortage that we had, and I'll show a few pictures in a while. And as Dr. Arun highlighted, we had a lot of issues here, even in Malaysia, of the condos and the various housing estates. They were actually creating special lanes just for the healthcare frontliners, in the sense they were trying to isolate you, segregate you, because they were all so afraid of the infection. And this is what we had to do. To overcome all this, what we did was we started a lot of simulations. So this is all of us preparing simulation. We simulated before we had our first cases. We simulated how to don the PPEs. Because we were so short of PPEs, we had to use the tudongs or the head covers that that from our staff that they donated, so that we could practice putting on the head covers. We were obviously underdressed as when we first started. This is me filming a video of how to incubate a patient with COVID-19 and the way that we wanted it, because it is an aerosol generating procedure. The necessary selfie, first time that I donned the PAPR. You know, these are things that all we were not, I would say we were not trained fully when we were younger, when we were in pre-COVID era, and we had to quickly learn this within a few weeks or so before we ended up with our first patient. What we saw was the whole country coming together. And this is something that I would like to highlight, that the pandemic has brought us definitely closer together. It has shown us that despite the political instability that Malaysia felt, we still could get through this. The civil service stood up, the healthcare services stood up, and we battled through the pandemic. And at one stage, we were doing very well until our politicians again decided to create a big, a big mess of things and call for a state election. And that triggered our second wave in Malaysia. But what we are facing now, after all the coming together, is the fatigue. Right. At one stage, I was doing 7 calls in 2 weeks. So that's almost every other day we were on call, a stay in 24 hour on call before giving a day off and then starting again. We were donning in at about 6 to 8 hours at a stretch for some of my medical officers. For me, it would be 2 hours each time, 3 times a day just to go in to see my patients. We were also trying to protect our most at-risk doctors and nurses. So those with comorbids, those were a bit older, those were pregnant, were excluded from the COVID rotation at the early stage. The youngest doctors, the house officers, were also excluded from COVID treatment. This in a way was, I would say, it was protective of the doctors per se and the healthcare staff, but it did not obviously give the best, we were not able to create the best environments for our patients, because definitely we were short of staff, everybody was tired, and it was the same people getting called into COVID rotations again and again. And the shortage of PPE kept on going on and on. So the deployment of staff, like Manisha mentioned, we got surgeons in, we've got nurses from unfamiliar. There was a lot of misunderstandings because I could not fully depend on my nurses to check to be my check and balance, because they were not trained for intensive care. Our reduction of our elective list, I'm a pediatric anesthetist by training. I've hardly touched pediatric anesthesia in the last 1.5 years because of my rotations, mostly in the COVID ICU. We did have our monitoring of burnout. This is something that we did. We created a departmental OSHI unit, Occupational Safety and Health, and we provided support to our staff and our nurses and our doctors. So we got a lot of donations. We had to source for it ourselves, unfortunately. And even for me, because I'm in a university hospital, and if you work with a governmental agency, you know how difficult it is. Even though the money is in the bank, to get the money out to purchase something takes ages because of the bureaucracy. And at the early stages, we did not have enough coveralls and all for all our staffs. And when we had to source for it ourselves, we had very good friends, very good donors that gave very generously to all of us. This is me with our first BAPRs that we managed to get, the Tyvek suits, the first Tyvek suits that we managed to get to bring into the hospital. These were the original coveralls, the Tyvek with the proper Tyvek material, not the, I would say, the cheaper quality ones that we are using now. And this is one of my medical assistants. He's about 6'2", quite big size gentleman. And we had no protective equipment that could fit him. And we had to source for it. And I had to source for it, especially from one of my donors, to get these yellow jumpsuits for him. And this was gotten from the petroleum industry in Terengganu, and we had to bring it over across the country. So we had to rethink, redo, and the task force was really essential at it. We had to relook at how we purchase equipment. We had to put aside a special budget for it. We had to ensure that all the staff were fed. The other thing that we had to look at was, of course, the welfare. Now, the nurses, the doctors, as I mentioned, 6-hour shifts in there. You come out dehydrated, you're sweat, you have lost lots of sweat, you're hungry and all, and there's nothing open because the economy was in shutdown. We have shut down the entire country for almost 6 months. So the hospital had to ensure that we had adequate food, adequate drink, all of this all had to be rearranged. We had to get in new caterers, ensuring that the food doesn't go bad, a place to heat up our food, and all this all had to be rethought. Then we dealt with a new issue about in-hospital transmissions from doctor to doctor, because we are used to sharing on-call rooms. So during an on-call, when you are resting, our resting area are all communal. So we had 2 or 3 people sharing one communal on-call room. And if one person is positive, the other person will be put into quarantine as well. So that created a big administrative issue. We had to open the wards that were closed for surgery. We had to open it as our on-call rooms to allow individual on-call rooms for all the nurses, for all the doctors for rest, especially during the night shift. So vaccines, I'm sure everybody had the same issues. Our first vaccines was on the 21st of February 2021. I got mine in March, early March, which was quite fortunate. We vaccinated the front lines as per every other country. In hindsight, we now have this issue where the workplace has become our number one transmission or hotspot. What happened was we did not vaccinate the working group fast enough. And because of that, when they went back and when we reopened and when they went back to work, then they created clusters within the workplace. And then when we shut down the clusters, we sent them home, they took that infection home and infected the families. So now what we had in the third wave, we had families, entire families infected with COVID-19. And these were young parents. The other issue, like what Manisa mentioned, was the protocols that change daily. And a lot of treatment, and if anyone here had dealt with COVID-19 right from the start, you know that we have been treating with azithromycin, with hydroxychloroquine, and now with the monoclonal antibodies, and the latest with the controversy of ivermectin. With every medication that we gave, it was an issue because we had to have ensure an ethical dilemma for us, because this is experimental. There's very little evidence. We had to explain to the patients with regards to the risk and benefit of each drug before we were to start. The issue being is that when you have very well educated patients, that's fine. They understand. But when you have patients that do not understand, and we do get quite a lot in the initial phase with the elderly or patients that are from a poorer background, a poorer education background, that could not understand or could not comprehend what is the risk of taking all these medications. So we ended up with quite a lot of discussions, a lot of video calls. And I think this is one of those things that changed our practice. We had to start doing a lot of video calls, which is something of a taboo for us in Malaysia, especially within the medical fraternity, of online consultations, online consults, and online consents. So you would video call the family members, you would discuss the matter with them, and then you would document it. So there's no recording of these calls, but it's just a verbal consent and it's written down. A lot of the family members, as Manisha said, could not come in, and that was again an ethical dilemma and something that we had to deal with. A lot of emergency surgeries had to be done with two surgeon consent. So the balance, I think, have been very well covered by the other two speakers. This is what we in Malaysia came up with. The Malaysia Bioethics community came up with a guideline for guidance for clinicians, and it's in our first edition. It does cover some of the ethical, I would say, conundrums that we had. However, I would say not many of us, it would be very difficult for us to apply everything in real life. I had a lot of stories to share, but in the interest of time, I think I'm not going to go into the individual stories. I will just cover briefly some of the ethical dilemmas that we had. We had a patient who had two families, two wives, that have never met each other. And it's only after his admission for COVID, okay, that both families called to the hospital. And we did not know we were talking to two different families until one of them mentioned that, please don't tell the other people that I called. We always thought that we were speaking to two daughters from the same mother, but in fact, it was from two different mothers. That was an issue that we could not disclose. The patient was very upset with us that we were communicating with two sides of it. We had to sort that out gently, I would say. We have issues with parents splitting up, and we had the young 20-something-year-old gentleman that was in here, and the father refuses intubation, the mother insists on intubation, and the patient is hypoxic and unable to make a decision. So, you know, we end up with a lot of all these social issues that we had to deal with. And this, of course, came at a cost for our own mental well-being. The moral compass, the moral dilemmas that we felt definitely was bad. I've cried many, many times in ICU, because before we intubate, we will allow a video call for the parents or for the patient to their family members. So it will be a group WhatsApp call for all the various family members that we will allow them to have some last discussion, some last talk before we electively intubate those that could still speak. I've had video calls of patients that have already passed on, and I had to video call just to allow the family members to see their loved ones for the last time before we perform the last office. And the new Delta variant has brought about a lot of pregnant women affected by COVID-19. And then the discussion, of course, is when to deliver. And it's always a war between pediatrics, ops, and the anesthetists. And of course, the mother is always the priority. But the more premature babies that we deliver, the more clogged up the NICUs become, and the less available space is there for other cases that come in. So justice for our other patients, Minasha covered this. And again, we have had delays. We have not had elective surgery. We have a lot of cancer delays. We have had cardiac patients waiting for CABGs and pass away because we could not get them onto a list fast enough. And of course, leadership. So this is our current issues. And this is my last, second to last slide. We've had our third prime minister in the last 3 years. Having a stable political area would have been very, very much appreciated. We've been in a state of emergency that's just been lifted a few weeks ago. We are now dealing with the anti-vaxxers and non-believers as we push towards 60% vaccination rates. We are dealing with a lot of foreign workers, and Malaysia has a large population of illegal foreign workers that are both afraid of getting vaccinated, coming forward for to get vaccinated, and live in conditions that promote the spread of the virus. So we've got to go in effectively to the workplace and to vaccinate them in the workplace itself, rather than waiting for them to come to our vaccination centers. The economy is opening up because we've been shut down for 2 years. The backlog of cases are probably going to haunt us. And the moral injury to the frontliners, to me, will be our biggest issue for the Malaysian Medical Association. So strong leadership is needed to wherever that we are. We need to keep supporting the frontlines in terms of ensuring adequate PPE that will affect our mental well-being and physical health. The economy versus health dilemma is a whole different topic that we could always discuss further on. And of course, the social responsibility of us as doctors and for the patients. So I leave you with this. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you very much. It was a very interesting talk. You put a lot of very important areas, particularly bringing in your moral distress and moral injury. And thank you for cutting short and trying to recoup our time. I'll have it handed over to Dr. Mary, who's probably going to manage this now. My apologies to you, Dr. Mary, for the delays we had and a little bit of problems with the time management. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Russell. And I'd like to thank, first and foremost, I'd like to thank all the speakers. Such a beautiful presentation. And yes, especially Dr. Kevin, thank you for bringing out many issues. Things, yeah. And the plight of anesthesiologists, what they had gone through, maybe a little different from the other healthcare workers, but a lot of it is the same also. But it's nice to hear. You covered politics, you covered, moral injury, which has been a hot topic. And of course, about vaccines and pediatric care and pregnant women and Delta viruses. So since we're running short of time, we have covered now Malaysia, we've had Scotland, we've had India. I will go to USA, and I know Dr. Jonathan is waiting there very anxiously. Dr. Jonathan, from USA, the perspectives, you've heard our speakers from Malaysia and from Scotland and from India. Was it very different? Did the anesthesiologist face similar challenges, or were they... were there new aspects to this?
Well, I think that Kevin covered pretty much everything that we're also experiencing. I think we have problems with a shortage of equipment, especially CPAP and BiPAP. We try to use the CPAP and BiPAP here as a bridge to prevent intubation if we don't have to do that. But at the same time, that equipment that's used for routine care can no longer be used. So we have a lot of morbidly obese patients that come in for procedures, let's say like a colonoscopy or upper endoscopy, and we need that BiPAP to support the airway during MAC anesthesia and sedation. And that CPAP and BiPAP is in the emergency room trying to keep patients off the ventilator. So we have a lot of similar problems with the issues, and we have a lot of patients that are coming in and unable to find a bed in the hospital. They're lined up in the emergency room, intubated or not. And that also uses equipment as well. In my hospital, elective surgery is being postponed, especially any patients that need to stay overnight. We're not doing any of those, or we haven't been, because all those beds are being taken up by the COVID patients.
Okay. So I think USA also had the same problem of leadership, and they also are now facing the problem of anti-vaxxers, and USA is now still leading when it comes to COVID infections.
I think that's a big problem here. We have a lot of people that are not getting their vaccines. Most of the patients that we see who are really sick are those that are unvaccinated. I think there's a large, anti-vax community here, but, we're doing what we can, with public service announcements and, our leaders trying to get more and more vaccines to the people. We have a really good system here where you can go into a local pharmacy and sign up, or even in the grocery store, we have pharmacies and, encouraging patients and people who are unvaccinated to get vaccinated. But especially in Florida, we're kind of a hotspot for COVID in the United States. And there's not much you can do until people get the vaccine.
But has there been a change in policy? Has there been a change in practice?
Not really a change in policy, but we're, arguing, our leaders are arguing mainly about problems in the school system, whether to mandate
vaccine.
Masks, or vaccines. Obviously the vaccines are only approved, above a certain age. But the mask, we have a lot of problems in Florida now, where the governor has stated that there should be no mask mandate in schools, and the school boards themselves have instituted mask mandates. So we're kind of fighting among ourselves. And it's going to go through the courts, and it's a big problem here.
Yeah, but are there any change in guidelines when it comes to practice of anesthesiology?
Not that I'm aware of at this moment.
No, okay. All right, so pretty much the same as in every other country.
Correct.
Yeah, but only think you made a point that you have a lot of obese patients, so that itself is a difficulty.
That's a definite comorbid issue that enters into the decision making, when we decide what we're going to do and what we're not going to do.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Jonathan. May I go to Dr. Joyce? Joyce, you're from Nigeria? No, sorry. I'm so sorry. You're from Kenya. Sorry. Yeah. Dr. Joyce, we'd like
to hear. Sorry.
I'm sorry. You're from Kenya, right?
Yes, I am from Kenya.
Yeah. So how different and how similar were the problems for anesthesiologists in Kenya?
Well, most of the problems were very similar in Kenya. Now, for us, we have another unique problem in the fact that we have 68 languages currently in the country. So in terms of language barrier, that's a problem in terms of getting consent, trying to make the patients understand some things. So that has presented such a big problem for us. So you find there are communication issues in a lot of centers because of the language barrier.
Okay. Well, what about the other issues regarding, of course, politics is common throughout globally.
Oh, yeah.
That's a problem. But anything unique about what you faced in Kenya regarding teenagers or young women or pregnant women or HIV or a new different illness?
So for us, in terms of when COVID-19 hit last year, obviously the population was very different. So suddenly we have pregnant women coming in with the variant and are coming in very critically unwell. So for us, it was the challenge of where do we put them in terms of, because most of the ICUs were not really designed to have maternal care.
Okay.
Right? So we had the challenge of where do we nurse them? And then the other challenge was when COVID-19 hit, we were isolating the babies and the moms. So if you have a mildly unwell COVID positive mother, she would be isolated from her child. So then again, brings in the issue of moral injury. What does that do to the mother? What does that do to the child? So those were some of the issues we were trying to address.
Okay.
So it's gotten better over time.
Yeah, there was what Kevin was talking about, you know, this issue about multiple families. Is it there in Kenya?
Oh, yes, it is. It definitely is. It's a very big problem for us as well, because you have that issue of who comes, because on most forms, you'll have the next of kin. Okay. But then you discover along the way, there's someone else who's the next of kin. So we've had issues like that, and it's been hard to deal with them. I like the way Kevin said, we handled it softly.
Gently.
So most of the time, yes, gently. So most of the time, we try and do that, but then comes the issue sometimes when the patient passes on. Mm-hmm. And then you have the issue of cultural practices in terms of burials.
Okay.
So yeah. Those are some of the challenges that we may have. Who buries who? Who takes the body? Who's the next of kin?
Yeah.
So those are some of the issues that we have.
So probably the morale of the doctors would have been quite low. You know, are you still, I mean, how is the situation in Kenya now? Has it got better or is it?
It's slowly, I can say slowly improving, but it's not good in the same light, because we are very few. We are about 200 and something anesthesiologists in the country at the moment.
Oh goodness.
And okay. Yes, so you can imagine dealing with the pandemic is very hard, and then more often than not, it's the anesthesiologist who knows about the ventilators and things like that. So unfortunately, when the pandemic hit, we were the most trained group. So now we had to rethink and see how to train others in terms of critical care. So okay. Now you have what we call medical officers who we are training to handle critical care cases. So it's been a learning curve, a steep learning curve for us. Yes, and the fact that we also short-staffed.
Yeah. So, but did you have many of your members, faculty, falling ill with COVID?
Oh, yes, that's another thing I was coming to. Yes, we had a lot of, and then now we had to quarantine for, initially it was 14 days.
Okay.
So you'd have a whole unit missing for 14 days, and don't have replacements. So it was very difficult that time. So you had to sort of train, like really quickly, the medical officers who were on the ground to take over some of those roles. So it was very hard for us.
Any particular reason why there are the number of anesthesiologists are less in Kenya? Is there a particular reason, or is it because it's a difficult job per se?
I think the main reason is that medicine in Kenya is very expensive.
Okay.
That's number one. And then anesthesiology as a specialty in itself was not a big field until in the recent past. So there were not many who would take it up as a specialty. So those are some of the things we're trying to battle with right now.
Okay, right. Dr. Joyce, I'll come back to you. Let me just get in all our speakers and then I'll get back to you if we have time.
No problem.
All right. Dr. Manpreet?
Yeah.
I cannot see you on the screen.
Yeah, I'm there in the screen.
Okay, there you are.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Dr. Manpreet, much of what is happening in India, Dr. Arun did mention, you have an extraordinary record regarding a procurement of oxygen cylinders, and am I right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so India was facing a massive shortage of oxygen, and you did, can you tell us what exactly you did?
Thank you, Mary, and I'm thankful to Dr. Arun and Dr. Russell, but first of all, I must tell you one nice thing here before going for my brief details, that here on this platform, I'm sharing with Dr. Ashok Saxena. He is my teacher and I wish him Happy Teacher's Day also.
Okay,
he is my teacher. So that's a nice thing behind the curtains. But yes, in India, we had a different challenges of oxygen. This was a different thing which we didn't have in the last many years. and we were used to have a comfortable zone of having oxygen and use of oxygen in the hospitals. I'm working in the northern part of India in Chandigarh, and I was involved in the procurement of oxygen and use of oxygen as an educationist in this, and how to create the awareness. And there were certain challenges which we faced this time in the second wave. This was the biggest challenge, was there was a huge increased demand of the oxygen, and patients from the neighboring states of northern India and from Delhi, from other places where the oxygen was little less, they were coming to our hospitals. And I'm working in an 1100 bedded hospital where I'm the nodal officer of that, and in the as a nodal officer in the Chandigarh big city, in the administrative part also in the Chandigarh administration. So what happened was that the demand was so much high that we couldn't have the supply in the initial part. Yes, we had three types of oxygen systems, which are presently also, which are we are dealing with. These are the liquid medical oxygens, then oxygen medical cylinders, and then we had the oxygen generation plants. And oxygen generation plants was a new thing which was incorporated in the recent times with the PM CARES and other funding from the government. And it was a big project from the government that we should have procurement of these oxygen generation plants, PSA plants, and so that we can have autonomy in the form of the having oxygen at our own place. That was the biggest issue. And then the second issue was the oxygen supply chains. This oxygen supply chains right from the generation plants to the hospitals. Although we had requirements in the at every place in the hospital, in the wards, in the ICUs, it was continuously increasing. As you all know that we all are clinicians, but we are dealing with patients only and clinical aspects only, but we don't think how the oxygen is procured in the hospital from where. And this was the biggest challenge this time. And like I give you a simple example that if you are using the non-breathing mask, or you are using the venturi mask, or you are using the this high flow nasal oxygen mask, the amount of oxygen which is required to the patient is enormous, increases from 15 liters to the 70 liters per minute. So that was challenge, how to cover with those in our supply. So what we did was administratively we got very much support, and then we had our own PSA plants which were installed. Then we increased the number of cylinders. Then we increase the number of this buffers of liquid oxygen. Then we increase the productive production. At the production level, we increase a huge number of oxygen. And what happens was only 20 metric tons was allotted to Chandigarh, where we had the more than 10 lakh people. So what we did was there were certain regulations we made, and we made certain oxygen guidelines, and we made a teamwork of 4 to 5 people who were including in that, who had different work of procuring the different hospitals, both government sectors and private sectors. So we included both the government sector and the private sector under one roof. We created a war room. We had a record keeping of daily, how many patients and how much demand is there, how many patients. We did the triage of tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 hospitals, so that where the oxygen is required in tier 3 hospitals, we shifted those ventilatory patients to the other side. And then where we didn't require the oxygen for much, then we created the huge bank of oxygen concentrators. Those oxygen concentrators at the source, those people who wanted, those patients who wanted less than they required 5 to 10 LPM of the oxygen, we gave them oxygen concentrators, and that was sufficient for them. Then we created an oxygen audit committee. This was a new thing, oxygen audit committee, which comprised of an anesthesiologist, a physician, and a nurse, and a senior technologist. What these four people used to do is they used to take a rounds, and they daily twice, and they used to decrease the demand of the oxygen by saving the oxygen. We formulated certain guidelines in our hospital and in our state, in fact, and those guidelines were followed as a UT guidelines. And in which we had certain conservation oxygen formula that we should use those guidelines to conserve the oxygen. And mind it, you will surprise to know that we used to save the oxygen. The aim was to save the oxygen because we are not dealing with the saving the oxygen. We are using the oxygen. So saving the oxygen, what we did was we showed those guidelines on the poster form in the education form. We use social media for these teaching and training of these under the webinars for those guidelines in the local area. And we used to daily save at least 2.5 to 3.5 metric tons of the oxygen from overall in the, and those oxygen, these 3 metric tons could have been used to another hospitals or another state we can supply. And then in the last weeks of the May, we had surplus amount of oxygen. And this was a huge achievement for us. And this was due to the role of education, awareness, with the clinicians and nurses cooperating with us. It was a huge teamwork. And with the Chandigarh administration and with the hospital administration, they also had the equal role in that. Then on the other hand, we employed new recruitments of biomedical engineers. This was another phase because recruitment is another issue in the government hospitals. So, but we did it in the COVID times, and adequate clinical case management was again looked after that with the micro teachings. Then increased subsidized transportation of the liquid oxygen tanks was another challenge because you have to, right from the production to the use of the in the hospital, you have to get the oxygen continuously, either daily or twice daily, or you will require the transportation of oxygen and the finances during the low economy phase is another challenge for the administrative challenge in the oxygen days in those COVID, in second wave of the COVID. Then this was totally documented everywhere, and oxygen audit was another thing which was done, a new thing. We did the audit of daily oxygen demand, oxygen supply, number of patients, and taking into the considerations of how many patients were on ventilators, how many patients were on different oxygens. So we audited those oxygen, and that helped us a lot in procuring the oxygen and maintenance. And also we had the surplus one, which was a challenge and again achievement for us for the Chandigarh administration.
Thank you. Wonderful. Such a beautiful initiative. We don't hear of this. Only on these kind of platforms, we get to know what all good work that, you know, people are doing, especially anesthesiologists. So wonderful to hear it, Dr. Manpreet.
Thank you so much.
I just want a clarification because this was the rumors were going on initially that the mucormycosis in India was secondary to the use of industrial oxygen. Was that true, or was it,
What I tell you about this is that there were rumors going on, and mucormycosis cases increased, but there was a multifactorial thing. It was not only, we didn't, in Chandigarh, we didn't use any industrial oxygen because we had full supply of medical gas oxygen with 99.9% of the purity. So that was with the liquid medical oxygen, continuous supply. That was our biggest achievement. And then mucormycosis cases, they have multifactorials. Some people have used industrial oxygen because there was a lack of oxygen at many places in India. But that oxygen, whether it attributed to the mucormycosis or not, is still debatable. And then there were other things like use of steroids. There was a use of huge use of steroids during these times, and people used to use methylprednisolone. Then they used dexamethasone. Off the counters also dexamethasone was given. But whether steroids have taken care, gone for mucormycosis, whether contribution was from industrial oxygen or whether some other causes of decreased immunity or the disease per se was there, it was still debatable, and it cannot be right now told that whether the what exact caused the mucormycosis.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Manpreet. I'll go to Thank Dr. So Ashok. Much. Thank you. Dr. Ashok, you're muted.
Doctor.
Yeah, now. Yes. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you're there. So, Dr. Ashok, you have the honor that you have a student here in the panel with you. That's a very rare occasion, but wonderful to see both of you together. I just want your perspectives on, because Delhi is also a hotspot when it comes to COVID. What were the other challenges? Because we have already gone through many of the challenges. What are the other challenges that you came across in the profession?
Well, yes, thanks very much indeed for having me on the panel. I would like to express my deep gratitude to Dr. Russell, and of course, Dr. Mary and Derek, everyone, and of course, Arun Mehra is always there. Well, huge challenges we faced. I would rather say that even if India had on a national level two waves, but Delhi had four waves in total, you know. This was the last one which happened in April, May, June, was actually the fourth wave for the city of Delhi. And I would like to say that, yes, you know, if I start with, you know, the typical thing everyone has talked about, you know, these COVID-19 patients being managed in ICU and the problems that the challenges, the ethical dilemmas that they faced. But another important thing, you know, which I'm sure Dr. Manisha also highlighted, was the backlog of the elective surgeries. Mm-hmm. And which obviously at our institution, it got converted to 100% COVID dedicated hospital. So you can understand that all kinds of elective surgeries were you know, they went into the backyard, because we were dealing now at that moment only with, you know, with the COVID-19 patients in the ICU and the emergency surgeries on COVID-19 positive patients, or maybe COVID suspect, but most of them were COVID positive. So the biggest challenge that we faced was, you know, the cultural issues, the social issues that we came across. And I'm sure you will appreciate the fact that if we are talking, you know, on the platform of bioethics, the bioethical approach is grounded very much into the culture. And why I'm saying that, because spirituality and bioethics are heavily intertwined with one another. And most of the patients that we dealt with were emergency cesareans, you know, those patients, those ladies who were COVID positive. And, you know, obviously the problems were almost the same for any other COVID-19 patient, but, you know, the mother and the child, then obviously it happens to be a very delicate issue, you know. So what here is, what we thought, that understanding of a patient's culture as such and developing a kind of connection with those COVID positive patients that I'm talking about, those mothers, it always helps in enhancing the care that is being provided to those mothers, and obviously ultimately to the babies also. So we had a dedicated COVID OT. We also had a separate OT for COVID suspect patient. We had a separate OT for COVID positive patient. So in that line we actually worked up. I'm leaving aside the, you know, those patients, you know, the COVID patients being managed in the ICU right now, because much has been talked about them. And obviously most of the time, you know, we were managing these patients. There were a lot of cultural issues. They were highly frustrated, you know. No one wanted to touch these patients despite wearing the PPE. No, that
yeah,
was
like a stigma. Problem. More
yeah,
of a stigma.
Yeah, that's right. The stigma, you know, that's why if I say that Article 10 and Article 11 and Article 12 of the Universal Declaration on Bioethics and Human Rights were not being followed and could not be followed, obviously, you know, it's such a mammoth task that you have to manage, and all those issues which are there. So these patients, when we normally manage, you know, either with regional anesthesia or with general anesthesia. But in these cases, because of the, you know, basically the intubation and extubation, and as already said, highly aerosol generating procedures. So we were sticking onto neuraxial blocks. Now, you know, obviously we preferred that, because, you know, the thing is that you're trying to avoid that aerosol. But then other thing which were there in the preoperative period, which I'm trying to bring out over here, is very important, is those type of things which everyone has dealt with, is the usage of hydroxychloroquine. Patients are already on hydroxychloroquine. And on top of that, there were patients on ivermectin. Now, if I say those kind of research frauds which which everyone has faced in this pandemic, on bioethics platform, don't you think that scientific integrity is perhaps declining? I would rather use this platform for that purpose. Recently, it has been seen, I would tell you, that the Academic Integrity Office of the University of San Diego in USA, I'm sure Jonathan will agree with me, they found 1,042 students guilty and integrity of the violation, which happened during COVID pandemic. And obviously, you know, when you talk about the ongoing research projects, everything went into the backyard. And if I'm talking about ivermectin, I'm sure everyone knows that on this July 14th, this ivermectin paper was withdrawn from the preprint server, what you call as, you know, the research square due to scientific dishonesty. So this is another thing which was happening in addition to what we have talked about. There was another paper which was retracted that was from world's most prestigious journal. You have the Lancet and you have the New England Journal of Medicine, imagine. Yeah. This was related to hydroxychloroquine and its cardiovascular side effects.
And so Ashok, it was the same author.
Yeah, that's right. Absolutely. So a kind of Sergi Spear scandal. And another one which happened from the Annals of Internal Medicine, where they backtracked on a highly cited paper published that was way back last year in April 2020 that asserted that face masks were ineffective in preventing the spread. Whereas in that particular study, they had included only four patients, imagine. Only four patients, right? Yes. So they had only four subjects, and this misinformation led to a kind of careless exposure, which happened. So obviously, millions of patients, you know, they got, they were not wearing masks following that, you know. So, during this pandemic, journals have had good, you know, average turnaround time, which normally happens to be in months. It was somewhere less than 2 months, and somewhere it was less than a week. So all those kind of things have happened, and those kind of research frauds have happened in the pandemic. So that is one aspect. Now, the other aspect which I was talking about is when we talk about, you know, those four basic principles which everyone has talked about, autonomy. Now, the autonomy naturally of the patient had gone haywire. Beneficence, when we are talking about the health, comfort, and the well-being of the patient, you know, to a large extent, yes, as doctors, we were very much concerned with taking precautions with limitations. When we talk of primum non nocere or non maleficence, obviously, no one was trying to do any harm. And justice definitely was being done, but then somewhere there was a compromise. There was a compromise because when you're talking about the effective distribution of the resources, we are finding that if we talk about HME filters, sometimes HME filters were not available, which we are almost changing on a daily basis. Or if I'm talking about the BiPAP masks, we were changing almost on a daily basis, but there was a limitation in the supply. But even then, there was a great support from the government of Delhi. I would still say that even you know, those remdesivir and all those kind of things were freely provided by the government of Delhi, which is again a great thing, I can say that. And tocilizumab, you know, though they again went into controversy, but then yes, we were using tocilizumab with the clear monitoring of C-reactive protein, and then we find that yes, you do a baseline, and then you give tocilizumab, and then you're repeating it 12 hours after that. So that was good thing on the part of government of Delhi as such. But when I'm coming back to patients' culture being, you know, you're trying to see that, I think that is a very important aspect, which actually has to be followed. Because we as Asians, when we are talking about, you know, you can come across a Buddhist patient also. So that's another thing where in the Buddhist philosophy, where when we actually talk about, you know, it is something like, you know, a naturalistic outlook that leads to a rationalistic and a very pragmatic approach that Buddhists are following. And many patients we manage were actually Buddhist patients, you know. So it's this kind of debate on bioethics and frequently normally focuses on practical relevance when we are actually talking about in the context of underdevelopment and geopolitical power, you know.
Dr. Ashok, we've had all these conversations on these webinars.
That's right.
So we've had even a religious, webinar just on the religious aspects in COVID-19.
Exactly.
And we had Buddhists. We had from, various other, the Japanese perspective. Yeah. We've had all this, so we know exactly, you know, what is.
So when I'm talking about those emergency cesareans, again, coming back to that, even emergency laparotomies where patients were actually COVID positive, then again, the question came of providing them elective ventilation. And when we are actually thinking about elective ventilation, then again, you find that we are we were falling short of ICU beds. You know, that was a big limitation. But somehow we managed because of the donation, which, you know, good number of ventilators were provided by PM Care Fund and other kind of donations coming from other agencies. So that's another aspect which we really, now if I really talk about, you know, these pregnant ladies when we are managing, you know, on one hand, they have COVID-19. On the other hand, they have those physiological changes because of pregnancy, where their functional residual capacity gets compromised. So this is where you find pregnancy itself is a prothrombotic. And on top of that, you have COVID-19, which is a prothrombotic. So again, there was a question whether to really enhance your dose of anticoagulants or go on the same dosage. So that is where we were trying to look out, and we somehow were following the protocol, established protocols, and we were still using our anticoagulants. The question remains,
And Dr. Ashok, we will take it in the next, we do have to take it at the next webinar, right? Because we are planning on one more where we will cover all these aspects. I do need to give time to our last speaker. It wouldn't look right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ashok.
Thank you.
Dr. Amit, I'm my apologies. Dr. Amit is from Nigeria. Dr. Amit, are you still on? Dr. Amit? Yeah, you're muted. Thank you very much for waiting so patiently. Dr. Amit, you're from Nigeria. Can you give us your perspective on, or rather, what anesthesiologists faced in Nigeria?
I have been in Abuja since past 6 years. Am I audible?
We can hear you well, yes.
And it's like since last year, 2020, when we had a pandemic. So, you know, because of everywhere the news was going on, but there was really no panic over Nigeria. They were just, they were just ignorant of this thing that this can come into Nigeria. Okay. And as of, you know, the African continent is more of like, they are very much God-fearing, God-believers. So this aspect is very much relevant for the African continent that no. When I was speaking to many Nigerians inside the hospitals, the staff and other doctors who are here, who matters a lot, they say, no, COVID cannot come in Africa. COVID cannot come in Nigeria. We are God-fearing people and it cannot come. So that was the initial challenge I faced, acceptance of this pandemic, that this pandemic is existent. It can come to Nigeria. And in spite of WHO warning that this pandemic can take a bigger toll on the population where there is lack of healthcare resources, especially the basic medical facilities, by the time like I saw the first patient which I saw, I think I am the first one who saw COVID-like symptoms in whole of Nigeria. I was the first one to report COVID-like symptoms to the NCDC Nigeria.
Okay.
And it was in February last year, 2020. That I was working in the operation theater and I was being called to see a sick patient in the ICU, and he was not responding. He was in sepsis. Dyspneic, disoriented, like in coma, and this doesn't fit into any diagnosis. In spite of giving dopamine, noradrenaline, fluid of 5 liters, the BP is not increasing. There is no fever. So I immediately asked the relatives, what is this? Do you have any? Yes. They came from the airport. They came from Lagos. Lagos is another city here, a port city. So he came from Lagos. The relatives were like, no, he has not traveled. I said, no, there is something suspicious about this patient. This patient doesn't fit into COVID. So this is from where my experience started. Now, after 2 hours, I was taking precautions. I asked everybody in the ICU, be careful. This patient is fitting into COVID. And surprisingly, after 2 hours, her wife arrived to tell us the story that he has been to China and he was there since past one month.
Okay.
So
You know, that was the first episode in February. All, every one of us in the hospital, we were panicked. Everybody left the hospital. Everyone, within 10 minutes, nobody was around inside the hospital. So, and being an anesthetist, you asked me that, what are the challenges being an anesthetist? And, you know, me and my ICU in charge, he happens to be a nurse. He was the only person present there. And I was looking everywhere, no help, nothing. And it was you know, it was a shock of the shock for me, a shocker. But being an anesthetist who is so much intricately related to the care of the patient, and that man, because he believed on me. He was a Nigerian, but he believed on me, and we were really taken aback. We called the NCDC. They came there within 1 hour, but I was surprised. They were not prepared. They didn't come with their team, and they left within 1 hour. They left without taking the patient. So that was the level of preparedness at that time, February last year. But down the lane, I must say that, you know, Nigeria is surprisingly has been very much successful in controlling the pandemic. And it was, you know, it started everybody is discussing the cultural and the leadership is very important in the country. Yeah. And the leadership has taken a stance in controlling this epidemic, especially since a very high ranked politician, he died. He returned from Germany last year and he died of COVID. So since then, they have taken a very strong stance in controlling the COVID pandemic, especially. So my personal view is that leadership is very important for prevention and spread of the disease, especially in the background of Ebola. You know, Africa was having this incidence of this epidemic was going to become a pandemic, and it was a lot of hue and cry all over the world. So this Ebola pandemic has really helped them in controlling the disease, not only in Nigeria. It has helped in all the continent, especially if you see the continent, the number of cases in Africa, it has been like a water drop compared to the other number of the countries all over the world. Yes. Last year, I remember WHO said that we will suffer a lot, and number of cases will increase. There would be all hue and cry everywhere. There is no lack of facilities in the healthcare, but surprisingly, they have managed very well. They were the first country who locked the country. As the first step, they also devised ways to stop people coming from outside the country. They into the also country. Started the quarantine strictly.
Yeah, so this actually is a very good example of good leadership. We've been hearing bad leadership all this while, but I mean, this is what, when you have good leadership, you know, it's protective for the people and the country.
Yes, it's true that good leadership is the fact to control the pandemic. For
Thank
my
you.
Case,
sorry.
Yeah, I would like to share one incident that once I was working in the operation theater and I was called for the ICU to intubate a patient, and there was only one PPE. So it was available right there. So, and actually I must not say, but I was prepared because I had bought the PP. I had purchased with my own money the PP, because thinking that the lack of resources are there in Africa. So I had to put my own money, and that PP helped me in covering up that bad case. So yeah.
I think all of you and anesthesiologists will have your own stories to write. You all can write books regarding this pandemic and, you know, how it has, because some of them are very, very interesting. Kevin's story is interesting. Dr. Amit, yours is. Dr. Ashok feels very strongly about pregnant women. And Dr. Manpreet also has a story. So these are, you know, things that, you know, probably all of you can get together and write a book on. It's really wonderful to see stories of success and how all of you have overcome, you know, this difficult time. So really appreciative of all of you, all the anesthesiologists who do good work and who work hard. I think ICU work is very hard. That's something I just sit near the and look under the microscope. So I don't, you know, I'm a pathologist, so I don't have that, experiences that you all have. It's wonderful to hear all of you. I think we are running short of time. Dr. Russell, I think we need another second session
on this.
So we won't crowd our stories, but do keep the stories for the next webinar. And I really would like to thank all of you, Dr. Amit, Dr. Jonathan, Dr. Ashok, Dr. Manpreet, Dr. Joyce, Dr. Kevin, of course, Manisha is gone, and Dr. Arun, for coming together on this platform to tell us about what is happening with your profession. And it's really, I got a shock of my life when Joy said there are only 200 anesthesiologists in Kenya. I think that is something I cannot even think of. You wanted to say something, Dr. Amit?
Yeah. It's we have a nurse anesthetist all over Africa. Trained nurse anesthetist. He may not be an anesthesiologist, but he's a trained anesthetist, and they are good in basic procedures.
Okay, right. Okay, so thank you very much. I'll hand it back to Dr. Russell. We've had a beautiful session. I'm very sorry. Apologies, because it took time to start, but I think next time we'll be a little more conscious of the time. Dr. Russell, back to you.
Thank you, Dr. Mary. And so again, I have to say it's been a wonderful, this is after 47, it's almost a year and a half. This is the first time we have, all disciplines, including economists and so forth, right? And so we had an interesting learning from what's happening with you, Doctor, from Nigeria to Kenya, and indeed Kevin's ethical dilemmas. He showed, I think, were very good, and also Arun set the scene. Unfortunately, yes, we certainly what Dr. Mary said is true. We are having, Arun has already planned. And if I remember right, Arun, I think you were also planning one later on pain. Is that right? But but we are definitely continuing with this, and we'll come back and we'll continue these stories, as Dr. Mary said. I'm sure even now we have over 100 till now there was 120 participants from around the world. Remember, to this program, you have people from South America to Africa, Europe, Australia, you know, the whole world there. So that's very important, and it's certainly great. So once again, we will thank all the very distinguished panelists we have, the presenters, Dr. Arun Mehta, Dr. Manisha Mehta, Dr. Kevin Shan, and Dr. Ashok Saxena, and Dr. Jonathan Evans, and of course, Joyce Ungaya, Dr. Manpreet Singh, and Dr. Amit Sharma. So with all this, thank you once again, all our participants. Thank you for joining us. I'm sure you enjoyed it. You learned a lot. We will meet again. And in fact, we have most of the places we've had two. We had with many because we couldn't finish it in one. And certainly here we will see the importance of critical care and so forth that the anesthetists are managing. So once again, a great thank you. Thank you, Dr. Mary. Thank you, Derek, for putting this and all together, and we shall meet again. So stay safe, stay well, and we shall all meet again. And I can again bring one important thing that we in this process have contributed and continue to bring solidarity and cooperation. Today is a good example where we see all of us very much sharing much of the same issues and going through this pandemic together around in the world. So thank you all very much, and we'll meet you again. Stay safe.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you all.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Arun. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Deborah. Hi, Karen.
Hi. I'm very happy. I'm very happy to be part of your team, Dr. Mary.
Yeah, I'm happy to see you.
In bioethics,
she's talking about
you're there in my team. Art. Yes, yes.
I asked Deborah to join for the
art. We need to plan, Deborah.
Okay, I want to talk with you after. When you have time to change my, to explain my ideas and the...
Okay, we'll do that. Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much.
I will ask Dr. Russo your phone number.
Deborah, we'll have a meeting of the steering committee and we'll get you to give your call.
Dr. Rizwan was there. He left. Dr. Rizwan from Pakistan.
He sent me a message.
Yeah, he was there. Okay.
Very good.
All right. Bye, everyone. Bye-bye, thank everybody. You.
Bye. Have a nice
Arun, thank week. You for organizing this. We'll continue. And Dr. Amit Sharma, Dr. Manpreet, thank you all for your and importantly, I think Dr.
Sir, I'd like to thank you for giving us the opportunity.
Yes, I think it was important. Dr. Ashok Saxena, I think, will be able to. Well, we shall have him give him an opportunity for the next meeting. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. It was very nice to hear.
Thank you, Russell. It was very nice and talking to all the people from my side. Thanks, Dr. Arun, for that. And Dr. Mary. Thanks for calling. Thanks a lot.
And good to hear your story.
Thank you for inviting me.
Karen's an anesthetist.
Karen, we should have you in the panel, because
I saw that we experienced the same troubles, the same feelings, the same fears, the same unknown things, and the same shortage of PPEs and so on, and common. And as Brazil is a large country, we lived the things differently in each part of the country. So it was very nice to hear.
Karen, maybe at the next meeting,
Karen, you could come in.
Yeah, come in so that we'll get an understanding of what's happening in Brazil. Yes.
Maybe.
Okay, I'll be in touch. I will ask Deborah to organize that with you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.
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 Bye.
Bye-bye.